I have the fantastic opportunity to interview William Quigley just a few days after Bitcoin reached a new all-time high. William co-founded WAX, which is a leading NFT blockchain platform, and Tether. And if you don't know what that is, you'll find the rest of the conversation comparatively boring, but we will define that for you at some point. Before we delve into this conversation, I want to disclaim that nothing that we'll talk about will be a financial advice. The reason that we are indulging into this conversation is purely for educational purposes. So before you consider investing of any of the projects, the crypto projects that we'll be discussing, please do your own research. Thank you so much for dedicating the time to have this conversation with me, William. It's such a pleasure to talk to you.
Yeah, I'm glad to be here.
So prior to your involvement into the blockchain ecosystem, you are a consumer-focused venture capitalist and you co-founded Clearstone Venture Partners. At the time, you were responsible for close to $1 billion worth of assets. And then you are also closely engaged in the video gaming virtual marketplaces. But when people within your close surrounding were initially telling you about Bitcoin, even though you were excited about it, you were quite skeptical because the concept of digital money was floating around since it's been floating around since 1990s. So you couldn't understand the full utility of it. You've shared this story over and over again. And while I was doing my research, people always ask you about how did you get into it. But what I want to know is how did you keep your conviction within the first 6 months to a year? Because I think that's the hardest part. But also, what were the initial challenges that you faced in that process?
Well, I'll first just say a few things by way of background. In the 1990s, when I was running a consumer-focused venture capital fund, there were attempts to create what I called, at the time, just internet money. So people would create a bunch of tokens and you would use those to buy and sell. And one of the reasons people needed that was because it was very hard to become an authorized credit card merchant. And even if a credit card company would allow you to accept the credit card as an online merchant, they might charge you 13-14% of the transaction. And so it was brand new area, the internet. There was a worries of a lot of people who would be scammers. And so these companies, one was Flues, another was Beans, popped up, but it was hard for people to understand them. And what I didn't appreciate at the time was the centralized nature of these tokens caused a lot of people to have doubts that this currency wouldn't just be produced constantly by the original issuers to cash out. So those things failed. And then I got involved with a partner of mine who wanted to try to allow people to buy and sell video game virtual items using like a centralized escrow service. And it sounded like a good idea. I had just invested in PayPal. My fund was the first institutional investor in PayPal. And so I thought, look, we can use PayPal, which is very cheap, to help people settle their transactions for buying and selling video game virtual items. And that turned into a very successful industry and a successful business. And if you now go forward to 2009, 2010, that industry was maybe $10 billion at the time of annual trading volume. It would go to as high as $50 billion once the concept of video game skins came about. But this is when they were just virtual items. But it turns out a lot of people who were buying and selling skins looked at crypto or looked initially at Bitcoin and said, hey, this is kind of cool. we're already using these video game items for payments, but video game companies often don't like their items traded, which is annoying if you've, you know, acquired those items and you would like to trade them for someone else or for some other item. So we all thought, wow, this could be cool. And so I don't think it's well known, but there are a lot of people early in crypto who came from the video game virtual item trading industry. And so having been in that industry for almost a decade by the time Bitcoin launched, I wasn't unfamiliar with what the benefits could be of having a globally accepted payment mechanism, but I was linking it back to the early days of the internet and those first attempts at making magic internet money. And I thought, you know, people are ultimately not going to believe in this. They're probably not going to trust it. My partner was really into it, though. So he was setting up mining operations and starting to educate me little by little. And in 2011, I was in Singapore helping somebody set up another video game virtual item marketplace. And she asked me, what did I think about Bitcoin? And that caused me to think, two very smart people now have told me that they're looking into Bitcoin. They think it's interesting. So maybe I should take a serious look at it. And when I got back to the US, I told my partner, I'm going to give you 2 hours. Give me your best pitch on why I should do this with you. And it took about 3 hours. But at that point, I started to appreciate the difference between digitization and tokenization. And once I started to go down that rabbit hole, I never lost any conviction. I only became increasingly excited about what we could do with this stuff. And then my partner and I began starting a lot of companies. We had other partners that we brought in. We did wallets, we did marketplaces, tokens, as you mentioned in the opening. Tether was one of those, the world's first stablecoin and the most traded token on Earth as of now. Yeah. And then ultimately we decided, hey, maybe there's an opportunity to put these video game virtual items on blockchains, and that's what caused us to launch WAX, which was the first attempt to do a NFT developed blockchain, just a blockchain for NFTs and video games. And that turned out to be very successful. It's for many years, it was the most active blockchain in the world. Now I think Solana's passed it, but on any given day, we would do anywhere from 5 million to 20 million transactions a day. To put that in perspective, Ethereum does maybe 1 million transactions, and that's because it's expensive to use.
Talking about it, yeah, actually Tether hit a historic 100 billion market cap on the 4th of March, and that's according to CoinGecko. It was just 3 days ago now. So how do you feel about it, and how do you feel about the stable coins market? But could you also explain to me, as I'm a 5 year old, what's the utility behind stable coins and why are they essential?
Sure. And that question of why do we need them? Why are they important? Was a question my partners and I got a lot of when we first proposed the idea of tokenizing a dollar. Many people thought, I'd say the most common thing I heard was, well, congratulations. You've digitized a dollar. That's been going on for 50 years. And I heard this often from crypto people. And I found that fascinating because they didn't understand the difference between digitizing something and tokenizing it. And even people who had been in crypto for years didn't understand that. And so the main benefits, and there are so many, I won't be able to mention them all here, but the main benefit of Tether as a stablecoin was it was built on another chain I was involved with called Mastercoin. Now that's Omni. And Omni was, think of it almost as a layer two on top of Bitcoin. The Bitcoin core developers didn't like it. They didn't understand layer twos. They thought we were polluting their blockchain. So the people who started Mastercoin, a group of them, including Vitalik, left and decided we'll just start our own blockchain and no one can tell us to go away. And at the time, it was pretty uncommon for people to start their own chain. Most of the chains in existence at that time had been forked versions of Bitcoin. And the idea was with Ethereum to do what Mastercoin had pioneered, which is to put an intelligent layer on a blockchain. And believe it or not, even that many crypto people couldn't understand. Why would you want a smart blockchain? And we can all look back now and say, that's why were they say so dumb? But I've seen this throughout my life. Really radical innovations often come with a lot of skepticism. And so Ethereum, of course, as we all know, launched and did very well. A blockchain that is a virtual machine. And if I go back to Tether now, so at the time we were trying to build Tether, tokenizing a dollar, all the exchanges in the world either were Bitcoin centric, you would deposit money on that exchange and get Bitcoin, and very few, and there were very few to begin with, allowed you to trade Bitcoin for all the other altcoins. If you wanted to trade in altcoins, generally what you would do is you would wire money to an exchange that allowed you to buy Bitcoin, and then you would transfer that Bitcoin out to an alt exchange where you would trade and do what you wanted to do. And the problem was, at that time, if you felt nervous or you thought you didn't want to be as exposed as you were to crypto, what you had to do was you had to take your altcoins, trade them for Bitcoin, and then transfer that Bitcoin to that exchange that you originally acquired the Bitcoin with, convert that into cash, and then have the cash wired to you, because these exchanges didn't really hold cash. And that whole process could take 7 days. And then once you got the cash, you probably wanted to be back in the market. So then you had to reverse course. And so it had a lot of fees associated with it, and it took a lot of time. And so our thinking was, what if you could convert your Bitcoin to another token that was a dollar equivalent, and therefore it would be a safe harbor for you in the event that there was a lot of volatility and you didn't want to be exposed to that. And so that was the main idea. And the other, of course, there are many, but the other was, in doing cross-border payments, it became pretty clear to me, and I had been in the payment industry since PayPal in the 90s, it became clear to me that Bitcoin was not going to work. It was expensive, the costs varied a lot day by day, and it was slow. And so it didn't seem like an ideal technology for cross-border payments, but a stablecoin is. And the reason why Tether is now the most traded token on Earth, traded more than Bitcoin, is because people understand that about Tether. It's just transferring dollars without needing a bank account, which is amazing capability. And there are other great benefits. One is also an extraordinary benefit, which is you don't have to engage in currency conversion. So if you want to pay somebody, let's say you're in the US, you want to pay someone in Germany, the way it would normally work is you would send your dollars to that person in Germany, but that their bank would then convert those dollars into euros and send the net euros to the person in Germany. Now, the problem is, though, there's a currency conversion cost embedded in that. And in what today is about an $80 trillion global economy annually, there's about $1 trillion of costs from converting one currency into another. And there's probably 5,000 or so financial institutions that get that value. So imagine if everybody had stablecoins in different currencies and never needed to convert those currencies. Globally, all the businesses and consumers of the world would keep $1 trillion in their own pockets. So this is one of the reasons, by the way, that I believe all of the world's economies, the big economies, will tokenize their fiat currency in the next 10 years. Because there really are no drawbacks to a stablecoin. There are only benefits. So Tether was the first. And I think you're going to see central banks issuing tokenized currencies in the future, because they're now starting to see the tremendous benefits of doing that.
There's so much to unpack, from the ETH, ETF, to Bitcoin, to central bank currencies. But I want to focus on Bitcoin at the moment, because it reached a new all-time high just a few days ago. And one of the analysts of Crypto Slate, James Van Strand, posted last Friday the $2.3 billion were withdrawn from various exchanges. Yet just around 3 days later, we reached a new all-time high. So obviously it's not financial advice, but I just want to know what's your take on it, because you've been investing into blockchain companies and cryptocurrencies for so long. I'm inclined to believe that there will be this cup and handle pattern where we've seen like the decline, then we'll see the increase, and then a sharp decline before Bitcoin goes to the moon, because I think that there will be a slight correction. But I want to know what's your take on it.
Well, I think you are correct that it's never a straight line for any traded asset, certainly not Bitcoin. The last time I ran the numbers, I looked at about 7 years of data, I think through 2021. So it was like 2014 through 2021. And Bitcoin, on average, moved plus or minus 10% every 3 weeks. And that was an average. And so, yes, it's constantly going up and down. And if we look at the patterns prior to a Bitcoin halving event, which is going to occur next month in April, think like late April, the next halving. And if we look at the previous ones and sort of assume, okay, the same patterns will follow, what you would expect, what has normally happened is Bitcoin has usually in the year prior to the halving, it's kind of hit its bottom and it start to going back up. And then right around the halving, it stabilizes a bit. And then, and this is important for your listeners to understand this, that historically, immediately after the halving, not a lot happens. Bitcoin sort of like, it goes up a little, you know, for about 5 or 6 months, it's not moving in a dramatic way. But then 6 months after the halving, and if you project that forward, then that's going to be like November of this year, 2024. If we follow the historical patterns, that is when Bitcoin will start to ramp up. And within a year of that, so call it November 2025, it will peak during that market cycle. And Bitcoin has done that in all prior halvings, and the multiple that it's gone up from the price it started at the halving it's kept going, but it's been cut in half. So the first halving, it went up about 50 times, the second halving about 20 times, the third halving about 10 times. So if we follow that, we would say maybe this time it'll go up 5 times, right? Because it's kind of been the multiple's been dropping by about half each time. Well, if you assume Bitcoin is 60,000, 60 or 70,000, but let's say 60 at the halving next month, 5x of that would be $300,000. So looking at purely as following its historical pattern, you'd say, okay, if it does that, Bitcoin could be $300,000. Now, if it's $70,000 at that point, then, you know, it would be $350,000. So that's why recently I said on CNBC, I said, I'm not predicting Bitcoin's going to hit 300,000, you know, 18 months post-halving. I'm just saying, if you were to plug in historical patterns, that's what it would do. Now, there's many people out there who are even more bullish because they think the prior halvings didn't have Bitcoin in such a respected position, at least in the U.S. capital markets, where the SEC has now, on January 10th, authorized ETFs. There's about, last I looked, 750,000 Bitcoin that are now held by the ETFs. At today's price, that gives you a little under $50 billion. And I'll tell you, for a new category of ETFs to already have amassed $50 billion, I don't know if it's ever happened. It's in this short of a time, in 2 months, it's incredibly impressive. So it looks to me like those Bitcoin ETFs will likely have $100 billion in assets before the end of this bull market, which is also, you know, it'll make them one of the most highest market cap ETF categories that exist. And once giant public market investors are holding Bitcoin, it's probably a sign that we don't have to worry about a regulatory intervention where Bitcoin is outlawed or something. I think we're past that. And so that, to me, makes me feel like this bull market could be extremely attractive for Bitcoin, as prior bull markets were right after the halvings.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. I've been thinking a lot about the optimal strategy to invest into Bitcoin, and I used to be the buy and hold guy. I was accumulating Bitcoin towards the end of the last bull market, and then I was still buying during the bear market. But I think a better strategy now would be to probably accumulate around 10 months before the halving, and then sell around 18 months after it. Just take some profits away, keep them in fiat, and then reinvest when there is the next correction. So I've been considering that trading strategy, which, again, not a daily trading strategy, but a longer term trading strategy. And it was supported by a prominent Bitcoin investor called Plan B. He came up with a chart that explains how this is the optimal way to invest into Bitcoin. So what's your take on it? Do you think that people that are within the blockchain industry should consider not necessarily trading on a day-to-day basis, but do you think that buy and hold is still a good strategy, or should we change that?
A couple of things. First, I would say the way you're thinking is, as we've just walked through, if historical patterns hold consistent, that would be the profit maximizing trade. However, since everybody else knows that, I'm not sure it's going to work in the same way, right? Otherwise, you get almost like a musical chairs thing where November 2025 hits and everybody runs for the exits. But then a few people say, well, I won't wait till November, I'll do it in October. And then someone else says September and dot, dot, dot. And this is a concept called reflexivity, which is just all the participants making decisions based on what the other, what they perceive the other participants in the market are going to do, kind of creates this chaotic environment that's very hard to model. So it's good that we know historically what could you have done to maximize profits. But if everybody else knows that, it might not be the trade that works in this bull market. Don't know. Well, you and a few other people could be the only people who really believe it, and therefore it works, or maybe not. So we don't know. And as far as acquiring crypto and how long should you hold it, should you trade in and trade out, there's so many things that go into that. It's like asking somebody how long is a piece of string. You know, it's like, it just depends. So, but if I try to put some parameters around this, when I do encourage people to have some percentage of their portfolio in crypto, 1%, 2% seems reasonable. But I also tell them that if you're going to acquire crypto, you should have an ability to hold it for 5 years. And the reason I pick 5 years is because I've looked at all of the bull and bear markets and lengths of time and whatnot. I think if you happen to enter the market at the worst time, at a market high, and you're willing to hold for 5 years, at some point in that next 5 years, you will be in a profit position. Now, if your holding period is only 2 years, I think that's very dangerous because you never know when you enter the market if it's a high or not, right? Because we don't know what the future holds. So 5 years gives you ample time to sit it out and wait for a good exit point. And so it doesn't mean I'm saying to people, hold it for 5 years, because you might decide you're in a profit position after a year, you can get out, but you should have the ability to hold for 5 years. One of the worst positions to be in as an investor is to be forced to liquidate at the worst time. Mm-hmm. And you want to avoid that at all costs. And then as far as what is an optimal strategy, setting aside what I've just said there, buy and hold is generally the best strategy for the simple reason that I think most people, once they exit a position, it's very hard for them to come back in. And often they just miss out. And because of that, that emotional element of investing, I suggest people just stay in. And as long as you don't need that money for a number of years, it's almost like having money in a retirement account. You know, do you really care if the market's up or down this week? You're not withdrawing that money for 30 years. So it doesn't matter. And that's the reason the retirement account math works, because people don't panic. And so the only other maybe twist you could make to this would be to say, have a dollar denominated exit value that if you achieve that, you will get out. Now, it doesn't mean that you'll ever be able to get back in at that price. Keep that in mind. But we do know that crypto has historically had this cycle where it goes up and then it collapses and up and it collapses. I see no reason why it won't do that in the future. But, you know, if you want to bet real hard money on something, you have to take into account the fact that history can the future isn't always going to be replicated the same way as history. And so be careful with that. Maybe some tokens, if you got in early and they pop, you can come in and come out. But you also have the tax effect, right? Depending on where you reside, taxes can eat up half the profits. So a whole bunch of factors that come into play when you're thinking about how to participate in the crypto markets.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. Oh, there's so much I have to say, and I love talking about different investing strategies. But I'd like us to move to NFTs. I attended NFT Paris, and it was an amazing event. But what I realized that I would say around 50% of the talks were about the utility behind NFTs. So how companies can utilize NFTs to build a community, or how a company can utilize NFTs to provide exclusive access to their customers. And I like that idea that NFTs are no longer only digital art or this comparatively speculative assets that you can bet on. Companies start to realize the real utility behind it. And I know that you co-founded WAX. So please tell me, what do you think will happen with NFTs in the next bull market?
Yeah, I have a presentation that I give about NFTs, and it was very useful in 2021 when everything was going crazy. And it explains that NFTs are much more than what most people see. In 2021, everybody thought an NFT was a media file, a picture or a video clip or a soundtrack that was searchable or findable on a blockchain. And that's a use case of an NFT, but it's not an NFT. An NFT is a remarkable innovation. It's a computer. It's a virtual computer. That's what it is. And this virtual computer has this really special set of properties. You can transfer this computer anywhere to anybody in the world electronically. And when the receiver gets that computer, they know with certainty, and they know without any cost, and they know it instantly, that the underlying software in that computer hasn't been tampered with. That's what makes them such special, special objects. And that's the reason why we can imagine all the use cases for NFTs. Ultimately, I think many forms of identification, national governments will issue NFTs because they can't be tampered with, even though they're tokenized objects. They're migrating through digital pipelines, so you can like email these things to anybody and know it's genuine. And then you have the ability to program it, which is what you were just talking about. And I think companies got really excited in 2021. The marketing staff were like, oh, we'll put pretty pictures of our brand in these things, send them out, and people are paying a lot for them. That was bound to die out because that was just a fad. But as companies begin to understand that these are programmable objects that can be sent to anybody incredibly inexpensively and certifiably authentic without any effort, those, I think that idea opens up tremendous opportunities for brands to engage with their customers. And then, as I said, for governments to use them as forms of ID. So I believe there will be NFTs everywhere in 10 years. People will have them. They won't necessarily think of them as NFTs. They'll just know that they have this object that can't be duplicated and can be used as a form of identification, or a record that everybody knows hasn't been tampered with. Courts could use them for that purpose. So yeah, I'm glad NFTs sort of blew up in the public, in the consumer market, and everybody got a chance to understand them. The word NFT became really ubiquitous in 2021, and that shined a big light on, oh, this is something blockchains can do. So it was a great way to introduce consumers to the benefits of a blockchain. But now we need to move past that from the pure speculation of, you know, Bored Apes to utility. And it'll take a while, because these brand new innovations always do. People have to figure them out. And then once they do, we'll see a lot more NFT use cases.
Yeah, while you're talking about it, I was just thinking about how you mentioned that central banks will initially come up with digital currencies, and governments will issue NFTs, and you might even have your ID in the form of an NFT. And in the last, I would say around 2-3 months, I've been thinking a lot about the inherent contradiction between the general data protection regulations and the right of every human being to be forgotten, and the blockchain technology, because it's an immutable ledger where everything is stored for the rest of humanity or until we have the internet. And that kind of scares me, because I have no idea how regulators will overcome that challenge. And I have no answer to how that will be done. Potentially one of the way is to do it is to have fully decentralized layer ones, where every single device is enabled to run a full node, so you can have all the data on your about yourself on your device, but it will be distributed. So if you want to unplug your device, the data that you're collecting on it will also go away.
Yeah,
but I think it will be a challenge that I have no idea how governments and companies will overcome. What do you think? What do you think about it?
Well, so I agree with you. I don't really worry about it, but I agree with you. You know, you're talking about an idealized future, right? Where everything works exactly the way people say it's supposed to work. But I have no idea if people will even want it to work that way. And GDPR, which for your audience who doesn't know that acronym, that is a European Union a mandate that companies have to implement very serious safeguards to protect private data collected online, and have to be have to allow consumers to have that information destroyed or removed on request. That's a fantasy too, by the way. Like, I mean, think about it. Once, if I'm a company and I've got a certain amount of data, and let's say I allow people to log into an API and use some of that data, even if it's anonymized, now that data has been removed from that server to dozens or hundreds of other servers for other reasons. The idea that your information is in one place only, and that the steward of that place pushes a button and gets rid of all of the data is not how the world works. You're never going to, idea of a right to be forgotten, the way the European Union did it was they said, hey, Google, people have to have a right to be forgotten. But Google doesn't have anything to do with the data on the internet. Google just spiders all of those domain names and puts it in a search layer and allows people to find it. So it'll unspider maybe an article about some teenager that's not complimentary. Great, but the article doesn't go away. You can find that article with another search engine. So, like I said, it's an idealized world, but it's not one that I think is possible to achieve.
Yeah, I agree with you. I was just going to say that companies tend to collect metadata about you. So even though they have your age, your sex, and other general information, they don't really know, they don't collect information about who your name as like your name. Well, I'm a bit concerned about blockchain, because unless, I don't know, it could potentially be tracked back to you if people have your private, if people have your public key. Yeah, it's definitely something that we don't need to worry about right now.
And if it becomes a problem, we'll come up with solutions for the problem. You know, I mean, there's every effort by humanity to make an improvement in our world comes with trade-offs, you know? Yeah. Like the internet, I think most people would agree, has provided spectacular benefits to humanity. Oh, it also allows people to say bad things about you online. right? Social media has some great benefits. People see a lot more than they did before. It has some drawbacks too. But I think we work through those things, right? And blockchain's a tool. We can fix certain aspects of it if it becomes a real issue. But people should be aware once, as you said, once a record is created on a blockchain, it can't be edited out.
Yeah, just to leave this conversation on a positive note, tell me, what's the biggest issue that you think blockchain technology will solve?
Well, I already sort of mentioned it, so maybe it isn't as exciting. But if blockchain did nothing else but allow the economies of the world to tokenize their fiat currency, it would be an extraordinary success. The idea that we individuals don't need to hold bank accounts in different countries with different currency around the world, that currency conversion becomes unnecessary in most cases, that there's an ability to accept a payment from somebody, even somebody you don't know in another country, and you know with certainty once you get it that it can't, that payment can't be reversed as it can with the credit card. And so you have much more confidence when you're serving a global audience as a business, in once you've been paid and shipping them the merchandise, it will definitely improve global commerce. So that's a magnificent aspect of what blockchains can do. I also think that virtual machines that Mastercoin pioneered and then Ethereum really blew up, virtual machines, we will learn more and more about how we can use them. You know, tokens that are tiny computers that can be programmed to do things. Like I said earlier, it's a lot to think about. And I think it's going to take a little bit of time for entrepreneurs to figure out an ideal use case for that. So there's, those are giant ideas, right? And in the video game world, the idea that the individual gamers can acquire the in-game items, they can trade them, they can use them, they're theirs, as opposed to the game company that either restricts the trading of that or shuts down, and even if you owned it, now it's gone. So that's a great application for blockchain and NFTs. So those are just a few.
You're such a big proponent that you're struggling to give me one reason, like one use case. You just outline a few. You're like, there's no one.
There are many. Yeah.